Good morning, Life Church. Would you stand to your feet? We're excited to worship with you this morning. How many of you know that our God is good? He is great. He's awesome and powerful. I encourage you to lift your voice and sing out as we worship. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. The grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Lord, we recognize you as the God who breaks the power of sin and darkness. You sent your only Son, who is sinless, to pay the price for our sin. We thank you that you love us so much. Thank you for your graciousness to us. You have been good to us and faithful. And so we praise you. We lift you up this morning. Everything.
Thank you.
you are good. You're good. Oh, you are good. Good. Oh, you are good. You're good.
Sometimes I think for some of us it might be hard to sing this song, to say, God, you are good, because we don't feel it. We don't feel like God is actually good. We might know that he's good, but at the core of our being, we kind of have doubts. We don't really truly believe that he is good. Maybe you've got a loved one that's passed away recently. Maybe your health is rapidly declining. Maybe you have a lot of issues going on in your family right now. And you just wonder, God, how can you be so good when all these things are going on? How is that possible? Maybe you have trouble singing this song, or maybe you're singing it, but the words don't really mean much to you because you're not feeling it. You feel like God's let you down. But I promise you that God is who he says he is, and God will do what he says he will do.
Amen.
And God makes the claim in his word that he is actually good. And furthermore, he says that he's working all things together for the good of those who love him. And I was reminded recently that the only condition of that is that we love him.
Right.
So if you love God, he is working things together for good. And you might not always see how he's doing that. You don't understand why these things are going on and how it could possibly be turned around for good. But if you love God, that's what the Bible tells us. That's what God will do, and that's what God is doing. And so that's where trust comes in. God, I trust that you are good. I trust that you are turning things around for good. You're working things together for good. So we're going to sing part of this song again, and maybe you need to lift your voice and sing it in part to convince yourself and just say, God, I believe you're good, but help my unbelief. I'm not quite sure if you are good. Maybe you have stories on end about how God has displayed his goodness in your life, and you just need a bit more time to declare his goodness. Because he has been good to us, hasn't he? He's been faithful, he's been kind, he's been patient, gracious and merciful.
Yes, he has. Yes,
yeah.
He has.
You're never gonna let me down. We know that you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let.
Come on, lift your voice, sing it out.
Oh, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. Yes, we know that you're never gonna let me down. Yes, you are good. You're good. Oh, 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 you are good. You're good.
Yes, you are good, good. Oh, thank you, Jesus.
I think it'd be awesome if we just repeated that, just said, God is good. Will you say that with me? God is good. Isn't that awesome? And I love this. How many know someone? Raise your hand. You know someone? If you know someone, someone is everyone. And listen to what God thinks about everyone, including you. Psalm 145, the Lord is good to everyone. Isn't that awesome? He's good to everyone. He showers compassion on all his creation. Did you know that you're one of his creation? And he showers us with compassion, and he shows us his goodness. Circumstances change. Finances change. Health change. Relationships change. God doesn't change. God is good all the time. He is so good to us. Heavenly Father, to that great and amazing God, we pray today. We just lay out the needs of our heart. Lord, we are emotional people, and we bring our emotions in here. Some of us are on the mountaintops, celebrating with gladness and gratitude, Lord God, and others are climbing the hill of difficulty. Some of us know that we're descending into the valley of difficulty. But God, you're the same in all of those situations. And I would ask and pray, Lord, that the compassion that you extend is extended, Lord God, today to the hearts that are sick, Lord God, to relationships that are ailing, Lord God, to hope that is failing, Lord God. Would you shower compassion to the things that are causing us worry and Lord, the dreams at night are disturbed because we're uncertain of our future. But God, you're the same, and we anchor and hold ourselves to you and to nobody else but you today, Lord God. Invade homes, the hearts of mothers and dads, and Lord, our students today, Lord God, rise up with courage on the inside of us. Lord, to the laborers in our oil industry, God, give them courage to put their hope and their trust in you. Lord God, would you hold the hearts of educators today, Lord God? And Lord, squeeze and let them know that you're the God that refreshes. And Lord, they have a place in ministry, Lord, forming and molding the hearts of those students today. Jesus, for the churches across our community, through this land, wherever we have come from, preaching Jesus today. Encourage those pastors. Step into those congregations. Lord God, show our United States that you are a God that shows compassion and showers, Lord, your grace on us. Jesus, we pray over our land today. Let there be renewal. Lord, you're an awesome God in this place. And you never let us down. And we apologize, God, for the times we let you down. But Father, you're the same yesterday. You're the same today. You're going to be the same tomorrow. We just take such great solace in that and love you for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. You know what I love about coming to church on Sunday morning? We worship this amazing God. God always has a positive attitude. I think Jesus always had an optimistic outlook. Don't you believe that? And when you come together and you worship this God, we kind of rally together and say, you know what? We can't deny that we're in the midst of uncertain times and turbulent moments in our life. But when we come together and worship God, there's a sense of hope. It's always yes, and it's always amen with God. He always has a positive attitude. You're on the winning team, and you've come together with a winning team. Give God praise for it. Shout it out. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah to a great and amazing God. You know what? With God, the glass isn't half filled. It's overflowing. Overflowing. It's just overflowing. I'm so glad that you're in this place today. I love coming to church. I don't know about you, but I'm happy when I get here, come here, worship here. We would love for you to take a moment just to say hi to somebody. Welcome them. Just turn around and say hello. You might recognize somebody and welcome them to Life Church. And then be seated this morning.
All right. Good morning. Good morning. I just feel like it is a good day when we can come together and we can just praise God. How blessed are each one of us to be sitting right here, to be together. I'm just grateful every time that we get to talk about how good our amazing God is. And so we are going to take our tithes and offering very soon. But right now, I just want to talk to you about our Connect card. If this is your first time at Life Church, we would love for you to fill out this Connect card. that's attached to the bulletin you got when you came in the door, and just take that to our welcome desk. That is just that long desk right over by door one. We have a small gift as our way of saying thank you for joining us this morning. If you would rather not do the paper, you can text the word connect to 701-490-8207, and that's just another way of you getting notifications when we have things going on, reminders about things like the week of prayer that we just had. What an awesome, awesome week that was. And we just love coming together as a staff and praying for you. And so if you would like to take that Connect card and just give us your prayer requests on the back of that, you can also text prayer requests to that same offering number. We'll take those prayer requests there. But our staff comes together on Tuesday morning, and we just pray for you guys. We just lift you up to our amazing God. And it is so awesome when we know exactly how we can be praying for you. And that's just important to us. So feel free to tell us your prayer requests. Let us know what those are. This morning, we are going to be really diving into just being able to give back to God. And so I'm not going to talk much about it, but just ask if our ushers, if our greeters would come forward, and if you would pray with me. Father, we are so blessed by so many things. And we just ask you, God, that you would multiply the gifts that are given to you, that your kingdom would just grow through the work of these people. We are thankful for each and every gift, and we just give that back to you now. In your name we pray. Amen. Go ahead and turn your eyes to the screen for some more announcements.
Hey everyone, Pastor Kevin here. I want to invite all middle school and high schoolers to a bowling night January 29th from 7 to 9 p.m. at Strike Zone. The cost is $10. That includes blacklight bowling and pizza. If you want to bring more spending money for arcade or more food, you're welcome to do that. We hope to see you there.
The Bridge is a Bible study, straightforward, an opportunity for you to read the Word with the pastor, ask questions. It's every Wednesday at 6:45 to 7:45. We give you time to drop off your children and then have time to visit and then also visit at the end of study. And we happen to be studying the book of Revelation right now. Join me on Wednesday night at 6:45. Love to see you there. The annual business meeting of Life Church will be taking place on Sunday, January 31st at 3 p.m. We will be meeting in the youth auditorium. Coffee and donuts are going to be served. You're going to hear about the vision of Life Church in the year ahead, and we have an election and would love to see you there. Members are encouraged to be there, and all of you are invited. We'll see you then, 31st, 3 p.m.
Good morning, Life Church. Men, we have an exciting event coming your way, February 26th and 27th. Men's retreat this year is going to be held in Devil's Lake. There's going to be barbecue, ice fishing, snow sailing, and more. Our speaker this year is going to be Heath Adamson. If you want more information about this event, go to Welcome Desk 1. You can sign up at ndmen.org/events. We have reserved 15 rooms and 15 spots in the van. So if you want to sign up for that as well, go to Welcome Desk 1.
Good morning, Life Church. I'm happy to let you know that spring life groups are almost here. But in order for there to be any life groups for you to sign up for, we need life group leaders. Perhaps you've thought about being a life group leader, but you're not quite sure. Or maybe you've had a great idea and you know that you would love to lead a life group. Either way, I invite you to a lunch we're having after services on February 7th. It's an informal, informational meeting over lunch. And to sign up, you can go to the welcome desk and turn in the form that you received entering the service today. Or you can go to the Life Church app to sign up there as well. I hope to see you there on February 7th.
Good morning, everybody. I'll give you another opportunity. Good morning, everybody. Who was hoping that it would snow? Anybody here? Yeah, I choose to love you anyway, you know? I take great solace in knowing this, that as you and I are seated in this building this morning, On this globe we call planet Earth, we are traveling 167,000 miles per hour around our sun, racing towards summer. Yay! So that's an awesome thing. Welcome to all of you. We're glad that you're here this morning. Just a couple of things I want to mention to you before we get into the message this morning. One is this, that tonight, there's going to be a service here tonight. And if you want to come back at 7 o'clock, there's going to be a guy preaching here. His name is Paul Egamiri. He pastors a church in West Fargo. It's an African church. We're looking to raise some support, some money, so that they can expand their church. They are packed out, wall-to-wall people, in this little tiny old building in West Fargo. There's going to be worship tonight and all that kind of stuff. If you want to come back at 7, that would be awesome. And then also to note that our annual business meeting coming up next Sunday afternoon, you saw the announcement, we have 3 candidates for a board position. Kim Schilke, Hercules Cummins, and Ron Jemison are those names, so that you know who those names are, and you're welcome to be a part of that membership especially. And then, one final thing is, at the end of February, we're going to have a baby at Life Church. Yeah, okay, let me explain. We have been just working on unpacking for you a brand new mission and vision for Life Church. And if you're one of the members, when you come to the annual business meeting, you get the sneak peek at what everybody else has to wait until the end of January or end of February to see. And we're just excited. We want 500 people involved in our life groups. Now, you might think that is an astronomical number. Listen, you know, we promoted the Secret Sister thing last weekend. You remember that whole thing? We're 10% there. 52 women signed up for being a part of Secret Sisters, which is a small group. We're 10% of the way there. Plus, I started thinking of all the other small groups that are already meeting. We're over 25% of the way there. So don't think that 500 is an astronomical number. We're going to get there, and it's going to be a lot of fun. And then we've got this new vision and mission that we want to unpack for you. And then our whole kids ministry area, we want to just revamp that so that when our kids come in to that place, get to our kids ministry location, bringing mom and dad there, it's like, wow, and we just want to make it miserable for you to get your kids out of there again on Sunday. And so all of that, we'll unpack more of that for you at the end of February. It's a brand new year. We are 24 days into this brand new year. And isn't it true that when the new year begins, there's just kind of this new hope? How many hope that 2021 is better than 2020? Say yes. Yeah, you know, so we put hope in that place, and so we started talking about how big our God is and how much hope we can have with this God that we serve. So we unpacked this a little bit, the size of our God. If Earth, this Earth that I talked about a moment ago, was the size of a BB, our Milky Way galaxy would be 29 million miles across. And scientists tell us there's at least 2 trillion galaxies just like our own. And if God can hold all those galaxies and all the stars within those galaxies in place, how many know he can hold your life in place? That's just the God that we serve today. And so that's where we started. And we began talking about how people make predictions for the next year. And there's all kinds of dire predictions for 2021. And I just want to tell you that if you want to know what's going to happen in 2021, read your Bible. Don't go to YouTube, right? Okay? Because your Bible has a lot more positive, optimistic outlook on the whole thing, and it is truth. And then we talked a little bit about how sometimes last week we make assumptions about God. We want God to be this God that comes through in the miraculous way for us. But sometimes our past experiences with God, I mean, God didn't come through, and he didn't answer this prayer, and he didn't meet my expectations. And some of those past experiences we have with God kind of paint and taint our outlook on God for the next year. And so then our assumptions about God, God can't do this, he won't do this, he won't do it in the future, he didn't do it in the past. We just talked about having faith and trust in God, which then leads me to this, the last, this is the end of the series, is we talk about trusting this great big God. If Earth was the size of a BB, our galaxy's 29 million miles across, this God that we serve is really, really big, and now we enter into 2021, and there's another point of contention that sometimes we have with God, and it surrounds the area of money. How many like to talk about money? That's what I thought. This is the money sermon, all right? Some of you are like, I haven't been in church for years because the last time I was there, all they did was talk about money. Or you invited somebody to church today and you're looking at them going, I'm so sorry, I didn't know, right? So how many of you in this room, how many have ever worried about money before? Raise your hand. You probably didn't worry about money. I mean, nobody puts a $100 bill on the table and goes, oh my goodness, what's going to happen with you? I'm so worried about you, you know. But what we worry about is what we need the money for,
You know, we worry about our debts. We worry about the bills. We worry about being behind on payments. And we worry about all of that stuff. So to begin with this morning, let's do a little money quiz. Let's see how good you are with money quizzes. I'm going to give you the beginning of a phrase that may or may not be familiar to you. And you see if you can fill in the gaps. First service, they got an F. They failed on this one. Second service, you guys have been up way longer. I know you're going to pass the test. Are you ready? So here we go. You finish the phrase. Money can't buy you happiness. Anybody say love? That's a Beatles song. Thank you. All right. Okay. That's both answers are acceptable. Okay. This one's from the Bible. The love of money is the root of, okay, evil, all kinds of evil. How about this one? If you can't manage a dime, you can't manage dollar. Yeah, I just used that on my son. That one's maybe not so popular. Don't spend your money before 8 o'clock in the morning, right? No, don't spend your money before you earn it. That's right. That's right. You can't serve both God and money. That's another good one. A guy named Thomas Tusser wrote a poem in 1557 and says that a fool and his money are soon departed. If you don't believe me, go to the casino or watch Pawn Stars, right? Okay, all right. I like what Jackie Mason said. He's a comedian. He said this, I have enough money to last me the rest of my life unless I buy something. Okay, isn't that true? And at some point in our lives, we've all been worried about some money. And again, not about the money. We're worried about the mortgage. We're worried about the car payment. We're worried about having enough gas to get to work. We're worried about the cell phone bill. And we're worried about the taxes that are coming. We're worried about all these other things and having groceries on the table. That's the stuff that we worry about. And we like not having to worry about that stuff. Isn't that true? So today, I'm going to unlock and unpack some scriptures, some stories, some passages that are going to help you, hopefully, not to be worried about how to make ends meet. Some people say, how come there's always so much month left at the end of my money? Well, we want to get beyond that. And I just want to get you beyond the fear. And on the other side of every fear, on the other side of every fear, there is freedom. And I want you to know that. We all like to have a little bit of money because we like what money can do for us. You know, money's kind of fun because money gets us stuff. Have you ever noticed that? Money gets you stuff. I kind of chuckle every time we go to the big box store. We're at the big box store on Friday because that's what we do on Friday because it's my day out of the office. We go to the store on Friday, and everything that you buy at the store, the big box store, you understand, you wheel it out to your cart. You get it in a bag. You might carry it out in the bags, or you wheel it out to your car. You unload it into your car. You go to your house. You put it in your house. You keep it in your house for a while until you keep it. Maybe you eat it, and then you flush it down the toilet, or you keep it a little bit longer and have a rummage sale, or put it in the garbage, and then it goes out to the landfill. And we just repeat that over and over and over again. So it makes me wonder, why do we want money so that we can buy stuff? We either flush it or throw it, all the stuff that we get, right? And that's just the reality of where we live. And there's something in you, and it's something in me. There's something in all of us that just wants more stuff. We just wish that we had more stuff. I think it's kind of funny. We just transition through life a little bit. You know, when you first get married, it's about getting stuff. You don't have enough stuff. People know you need stuff, so they buy you either a blender or can opener or a cutting board when you get married. And, you know, you get married and you have 27 cutting boards. You know how that is, right? And then you have a rummage sale, and you laugh because that happened when you got married. And then you have children, and when you have children, you need more stuff, and so you acquire all of this stuff. We only had one child, so we didn't have as much stuff, and now our son just bought his first home because he's begun his career as a professor, and we were so happy to load up our truck and give him his stuff back, right? Get it out, because at the end of your life, all you need is a recliner and a remote control and the TV. That's all you need, right? Don't need a lot of stuff, but we like stuff in our lives. And you know, having stuff isn't a rich or a poor thing. It's just a heart thing. Doesn't matter if you're rich or you're poor. Rich people want more stuff and poor people want more stuff because it's a heart thing. The smartest man who ever lived, his name is Solomon. He was also, I think, just undoubtedly, hands down, the wealthiest guy that ever lived. Really, at the end of his life, had some interesting observations about money and wealth. I like what he says in Ecclesiastes 5:10. This is fun. Look what he says. Those who love money will never have enough. Kind of true, isn't it? Because inside all of us, there's this little greed monster. And then he says, how meaningless to think that wealth brings true happiness. He received his income. If you read about King Solomon in the book of Kings and in Samuel, you can read about this guy. His wealth was measured in tons. He had tons of gold brought to him on an annual basis. In fact, when Solomon was the king, There was so much gold in the land that silver was seen to be worthless because it was just so common, because he had so much gold. So this guy knew what he was talking about when he talks about money. And then this is fun. Look at verse 11. The more you have, the more people come to help you spend it. Isn't that true? Aren't there some lottery shows on TV and all of a sudden you win the lottery, like nobody knew your name, and all of a sudden here's like your great-great-great-nephew Bobby. Hi, you know, right? And isn't it true that when you met somebody or heard about somebody that came into a whole lot of money or you found out they had a whole lot of money, if you didn't say it, you thought it. I could use some of that money. So we all know how to spend somebody else's money. So he says, what good is wealth except maybe just to kind of watch it slip through your fingers, right? And we've all watched money slip through our fingers. We all have. And then he says, finally in verse 12, people who work hard, well, they sleep really well whether they eat little or much. But the rich, well, they seldom get a good night's sleep. And I think that's because Warren Buffett said this. He's this wealthy American guy that lives in Omaha. He said, look, if you don't find a way to make money while you sleep, well, you're just going to work until you die. So here's Warren Buffett. I wonder how well he sleeps at night because his money's working for him while he's asleep. But maybe he doesn't sleep that well. But what if our wealth wasn't measured in what we get? What if wealth wasn't measured in how much we have in our bank account, in our pocket, stuffed in the mattress? What if wealth wasn't measured in what we get, but rather what if wealth was measured in what we give away? Now that's a concept that is so anti-American. It just goes against us in so many ways. To prove the point, when Jesus was talking to a group of people on the issue of money, he made this fascinating statement in Luke chapter 12, verse 15. He said, beware! He said, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you own. To which we'd say, yeah, it is. I mean, that's how we measure everybody, isn't it? It's measured in how much you own. We could walk out in the parking lot today, and we could start to measure people by the make and the model of their car. Some of us, because there's nothing much to do in the summertime in Williston, you drive around with the windows down, and we'll drive by your house, and I'm going to go by your house, and I'm going to see what kind of house you have, what make and model of car you have, how many boats you have, how many RVs you got, just all that kind of stuff. We measure people, we value people, and we value life based upon what we own. It's a reality. It's just the way we look at people. And Jesus said, well, that's not the way I measure people. Because what if we didn't measure people in what you get? Maybe you get credit for what you give away. And none of us really gets credit for what we earn. We only get credit, at least from God, for what we give away. And do you know why that is? Because when we go away, when we leave this earth, we all leave with the same amount we came with. You ever thought about that? Money can't buy you happiness. And I love this. We all leave with the same amount of money. All of us leave with the same amount of money. Did you hear the story about the really, really wealthy, stingy guy? Like, he didn't even want to spend money on his wife. In fact, when he said, it was in his will that when I die, I want to be buried with all my money. He wanted his cash in the casket with him. Well, he didn't marry no dummy, because when he was laying there in the casket, right before they closed it, his ex-wife went up there with a big bag, unloaded all the cash out of the casket, and put a check in there instead. See? Yeah. If you've ever been afraid of not having enough, and we'll talk about enough in just a moment. There's a principle I want to share with you from Scripture, and I'm going to use just this little Old Testament story to share with you a principle about putting God first in your giving. And here's the principle I want you to garner in your heart. Gather this in your heart, would you? That if you put God first in your giving, He'll put you first in your living. And some of you know that. Some of you have experienced that. Some of you have learned it. Some of you were taught that concept. But I want to share with you the principle of putting God first in your giving and then knowing that He'll put you first for your living so that you don't have to worry about money anymore. And then, when we're all done today, you're going to hear a true story from real people that attend this church on how that became a reality in their life, that on the other side of fear, they found freedom. So here's the background of the story. It's about a guy named Elijah. Elijah is a prophet in the Old Testament. He's a spokesman for God to the nation of Israel. He represents God to the nation of Israel. And so whenever Elijah shows up on the scene, he's kind of like God in that place. And there's a principle that we can learn here. Elijah is going to approach a king. His name is Ahab, and Ahab is a wicked, wicked king who's turned his back on God altogether, and God wants to get the attention of Ahab the king and the nation of Israel. And he feels the way that he can do this is to bring on a drought and a famine. How many know that when you're hungry, you're a lot more willing to listen? I mean, maybe that's where you're at today. You're in a financial famine. And in a financial famine, we're willing to listen to some options. Maybe somebody else has a better financial plan for us. So Elijah comes to the king, and he makes this proclamation in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1. He goes to the king, and he says, "As surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, Mr. Ahab, the God that I serve, there's going to be no dew or rain during the next few years until I give the word. If there's no rain, there's no crop. If there's no crop, there's no food. If there's no food, there's hungry bellies." God wants your heart. He wants your heart. He wants your devotion. In fact, I think he wants it so much, he's waiting to lavish on all of us his miraculous provision power. But we think we can solve our own problems. And God so many times says, "You go right on ahead. Go right on ahead. Try it." And I think we can live in this time of famine just like they did in Israel at this time. There's uncertainty about what's ahead. There's a new administration. We don't know what's going to happen with an oil industry. You don't know what's going to happen with your job. There's a lot of uncertainties about the economy. We just don't know. So I'm telling you this morning, what if we anchor our hope and our faith and our trust in a God who makes himself known and has never been proven to be a liar or cheap? So Elijah comes in there. Now he makes this proclamation to the king. And the famine comes to the land. There's hardly anything left to eat. And Elijah comes to this little dusty town called Zarephath. And when he gets there, he sees on the outskirts of the town a widow. And a widow says something to me as I read this, because when you were a widow, you had no earning power. There was no man in your life unless you had a son or children old enough to earn some income for you. So we know that she's very poor already because she's a widow. She's out gathering some sticks. Elijah meets her on the outskirts of this little village, and he says, "Would you mind maybe drawing some water from the well? I'm very thirsty for my journey. Oh, and one other thing, could I please have some bread to eat?" And her response is very interesting. In verse number 12, she says, "I swear by the Lord your God that I don't have even a single piece of bread in the house." In other words, I'm broke. I'm broke. Probably all of us in this room at some point in our life have been broke. Isn't it amazing when you're broke how much 10 bucks can be? If you went to college and you had a $10 bill, you were rich. Like, you could do so much with 10 bucks. She's got nothing. She elaborates a little bit more. She says in the rest of verse 12, "Look, I only have even just a handful of flour left in a jar and a little bit of cooking oil in the bottom of a jug, and I was going to gather a few sticks to cook this little meal, and then my son and I are just going to die." As I read this, it's just almost humorous in my mind. She was just going to bake some bread, say to Johnny, "Let's sit down now," and her and Johnny sit down to the table, and they eat their morsel of bread, and then they just stare at each other until one of them drops off. Right? When I read the Bible, I read it differently than maybe you read it, but I mean, it's just hopeless. It's a hopeless situation for her. "I've got nothing." And all that she can see is this little handful. And sometimes all that we can see are the little handfuls that we have. We don't see what our God has. We only see what we have. But I want to remind you who this God is. He's the God that owns all the rain, makes all the rain. He's the God that made the dirt. He's the God that makes the seed in the dirt germinate. He's the God that provides the job. He's the God that provides the income. He's the God that has limitless resources. That's the God that we serve. But sometimes all we see is what's in our checkbook. Perspective can be so different, even on that. In a marriage, you know, when Robin and I were first married, I can remember, because she worked at Bonanza at the time, and I had a job downtown, and we made nothing. I mean, we were not wealthy at all, and I loved to go out and eat, and I remember, here's perspective, I said one night, "Let's go out for supper." She said, "We can't, we're broke," which might have been a reality for us. And I said, "Well, how much money's in the checkbook?" She said, $70. "Let's go out to eat." Verse 13, the story gets better, though. It's got a silver lining on the gray cloud, Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid." Elijah, the representative of God, looked at her crucial crisis and said, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid." And I'm telling you today, when you put your trust and your hope in God and you're obedient and you put Him first in your giving, I can confidently tell you, don't be afraid. And he says, go ahead and do just what you said. In other words, go ahead and bake your bread for you and your son, but make some bread for me first. Wait. Elijah, like, I don't even know you. You're a stranger that just came into town, got no relationship with you. Why should I make you something to eat before my son and I eat? I mean, what a great challenge that was for this woman, was it not? I mean, really? Elijah, you almost sound like the pastor of Life Church who says we should give money to the church before we... Okay, all right. That's coming later in the service, just so you know. I want to tell you that if you know God more than you know your fear, if you know God more than you know your fear, you can fight 100 battles and win every time. But you got to know God more than you know your fear. Now, Elijah says, you feed me first, and here's the reason why, verse 14. Because this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. This is not what the YouTuber says. This is not what the news headlines say. This is not what the booklet or the pamphlet or the brochure says. This is what God says. He said, there's always going to be flour and olive oil left in your containers until the time when the Lord sends rain and the grapes grow again. In other words, you're always going to have enough. You're always going to have enough. Here's a question for you. You ever got out a pen and paper and ever sat down and really calculated how much enough is for you? Because a lot of times people say, if only I had enough. And enough is this ethereal kind of mist out there somewhere. We really don't know. So I'd say to you, how much for you is enough? I know the answer. It's less than you think it is. We live in America. Enough is never enough. But enough is enough. And I know it's enough because there were times my mother would shake her finger in my face and say, enough is enough. Okay. Saying, but this is all a heart issue. It's just a heart issue. It's not a money issue. It's a heart issue. It's our trust in God. You know. Little boy went to school one day, and it was his first day of school, first grade. You can say the Pledge of Allegiance. And teacher said, everybody put their hand on their heart, and everybody put their hand on their heart. And so this little boy put his hand right here. And they said the Pledge of Allegiance. She said, son, your heart is up here. No, it's not. Oh, well, it's not down there. She says, yes, it is, because this morning when I left for school, my granny patted me right here and said, bless your little heart. She said, you remember nothing else about this message except that joke. Now, here's what I love. This is the turning point. This is the power in the story. Look what this widow does in verse 15. She did as Elijah said. And she and Elijah and her family continued to eat for many days. She did, and God did. If you will, God will. If you can, God can. I'm just telling you, God meets us at our place of obedience when it comes to our giving. She does it. Verse 16 says, there was always enough flour and olive oil left in the containers, just as the Lord had promised through Elijah. God made the promise. And you know what? When God makes a promise, you can trust the promise. And I'm going to read to you a promise that God makes to us in just a moment. God is not a liar. God is not fickle. God is not cheap. God is not discompassionate or uncompassionate or unfeeling. He knows our needs. And listen, the whole area of us giving in the church. Now, I'll give you the biblical principle that I want to start with in just a moment. The whole thing is about us giving to fight the greed and the need on the inside of us. There's a little monster that lives inside of you and inside of me, and it's called greed. Jesus said, beware of every kind of greed. He just knew that we fight this battle on the inside to have more, to want more, the fear of not having enough. And so there's a passage that maybe you've heard preached before from the last book of the Old Testament. And this, again, is another prophet, and he's speaking to people. And there's just a great word here. And let me read this, and then I'll explain the context for you. He says in chapter 3, verse number 10, bring all the tithe, and I'll tell you what that is in just a moment, bring all the tithe into the storehouse so that there will be enough food in my temple. In the Old Testament, there was one central location for worshiping God. It was the temple. Inside the temple was the Ark of the Covenant that Indiana Jones made famous on TV and in reruns on movies and over again. But that was the representative place where God's presence was. Priests, men, would come and do ministry in the presence of God. They acted as go-betweens between this holy God and unholy people. And God instructed the nation of Israel, when you come to worship me, bring a tenth part of your wheat, your barley, your grain, your olive oil, bring a tenth part of all of that stuff into my storehouse, into the temple, because that's what the priests are going to live on. But even more than being food and provisions for keeping the temple and maintaining the temple, it was maintaining the giver's heart. That's what the whole principle was. God knew that there would be this greed monster in the inside of all of us, and he knew the only way to fight that was to bring a tenth part, a.k.a. tithe. You heard Serena mention tithe earlier. Tithe probably does not come up very much in your vocabulary throughout the week. Hey, how's your tithe today? I mean, we just don't talk about it. It's kind of a churchy word, but it just means 10%. And I think that 10% of whatever you make is a great starting point, not the ending point, but a great starting point to bring and worship God. It's just incredible what God can do if you bring that tenth part. Don't let 10% be your ceiling in giving. Let it be the floor in your giving, the starting place for you. Now, I know there can be some pushback because you've had just enough exposure with church to say something like this. Well, Pastor, that's an Old Testament thing. I know it's close to the New Testament, but it's an Old Testament thing. And nowhere in the New Testament does it say anything about tithing. So you just take that sermon and stick it in your hat or do whatever you want to do. Like, okay, all right. So you are absolutely right. Absolutely right. In the New Testament, Jesus assumed ownership over 100% of everything that we own. How many want to be an Old Testament believer, right? Let's just go back to the Old Testament, okay? And I know the pushback can be, 10%, like you're just trying to wrap your mind, like what kind of a cultic church is this? No, listen. You're trying to wrap your brain around that whole 10%. Because you're thinking, how could I possibly live off 90%? You can. It's just amazing what we can do when we trust our resources and our finances to God. Look what God says. If you do this, let's start with this 10%. You bring it to church. If you do, he says in verse number 10, if you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, and I think he says the Lord of heaven's armies to say, I'm pretty big. I'm the big guy. I'm in charge. I know what I'm doing, right? I will open the windows of heaven for you, and I'll pour out a blessing so great that you don't even have enough room to fit it. How many know that heaven's got some pretty big windows? How many know that God's got some more blessings that you don't know about? See, sometimes we don't see what's up in heaven. We only see what's in our wallet or in our bank account. I'm telling you, God says, I will open the windows of heaven and pour out so many blessings, you can't even contain it all. I could tell you story after story after story, but you're going to hear another story. You'd expect to hear tithing and giving stories from the pastor. Like, Pastor, that's why we pay you, is to tell these stories, right? But here's what I love. Look at this is just a phenomenal part of this verse. Look at the end of verse number 10. Look what God, this is God telling you and me this. Try it. He says, try it. Put me to the test. This is the only place in the whole Bible we are invited to test God. If we could go back to the old Life cereal commercial. Try it. You'll like it. He likes it. Hey, Mikey, you know, okay, I'm old, right? I'm so old, I remember tube television sets, right? So anyway, try it, you'll like it. I'm just telling you, try it, you'll like it. I put out this challenge in the first service. I know I got board members maybe in the service and staff members here, like, you start to tithe, you start to give 10% of your income to the church, and if you regret it, we'll give you your money back. Well, what do we got to lose? Like, this isn't a church thing, this is a heart thing and a thing between you and God. He just says, try it. And you'll like it. Put me to the test. And then I love what he says. Look at verse 11. Look, your crops, if you start doing this, they're going to be abundant, for I'm going to guard them from the insect and disease, and your grapes aren't going to fall from the vine before they're ripe, says the Lord of heaven's armies. In other words, I'm going to protect income that you don't have yet. I could provide a job that you don't know that you need yet. I'm thinking about your future. You're only thinking about right now. But I'm already putting you in ahead of me as I'm thinking about you because you have thought about me. When you put God first in your giving, he puts you first in the living because it's proof. See, money is just this tangible way of saying, I really do trust you. I really do trust you because I get the power of money. I understand it. I understand the worry and the angst over not having enough money. But I'm listening. Just, do you think God wants to fail you? Does he want to see you fail? Does he want to see you file for bankruptcy and go broke? Listen, he wants to see you succeed and do well, to have enough. He loves you and he cares about you. There might be fear today and you're thinking, well, how am I going to pay the rent? How do I pay the mortgage? I'm already behind on car payments. I'm at risk of losing heat. I don't know how I'm going to pay this cell phone bill. I don't know what I'm going to do. I just don't know. Let me just encourage you with a couple of statements, and then I'm going to ask you to watch a video. Would you devote yourself to the provider instead of the provisions? See, we live in a culture that tells us to devote ourselves to the provisions. Go buy more, get more, finance more. I'll give you a credit card offer so that you can get more, buy more, and have more. And we devote ourselves to the provisions instead of devoting ourselves to the provider. And if we devote ourselves to the provider, the provisions just seem to naturally come. Let me say this, one last remark for you this morning is this, that if you're fearing not having enough money, if you're fearing the whole area of finances in your life, I understand that. But on the other side of fear, there's always freedom. On the other side of fear, there is freedom. On the other side of fear, there is freedom. And if you don't believe me, watch this story and see for yourself just how people can find freedom when they get beyond their fear and start to trust God with what God has done for them. A real story, real people that worship with you on a Sunday morning. Watch this.
Daniel and I had committed to being very part of the church and making sure we were tithing regularly and being very active members of the church. And so we'd gone through some struggles and we got to a point where we'd paid all of our bills and we only had $100 left and we still needed gas and groceries. And Daniel was committed to tithing that last $100. And I was fearful and was like, well, we still need gas to get to work and we need food for the week and we don't get paid for another week. And I was very stressed and very emotional about it. And, you know, we went back and forth about it. And then we had the meeting with Pastor. And I remember going, we're gonna ask Pastor about it and see what he says. And I was hoping he was gonna be on my side.
But he wasn't.
But he wasn't. So when we asked Pastor about it, you know, he was honest and said, you know, tithing is something we should all do, and that if my husband was telling me that that's what God was telling him to do, then I needed to follow and put my faith into God. And that's what being a member of church is all about, is putting your faith in God and trusting that God's always going to provide. So when we left our meeting with Pastor, we tithed our last $100. And it was a very stressful moment for me. I was crying while I was doing it. So
the Lord provides.
Yeah.
Every time.
We somehow made it through the week, mm-hmm. and had enough gas, and we didn't worry about food at all that week. And I remember getting to the next pay period and being like, how did we make it through? Like, what even happened? Like, there's nothing that can explain what happened. And so I knew then that, okay, I put my faith in God. I trusted in him. I prayed after we left that, you know, he would provide for us, and he did. And so from that moment on, I knew, like, tithing is very important. Like, there's something behind that. Like, giving to the church is what God wants. Like,
I mean, it's you putting your whole trust and your whole faith, and I mean, it's just on one aspect of life, but in God on that aspect of your finances, by saying, okay, look, here, here's my last thing. I trust in you. You're going to provide for me. And he does, you know. And I used to stress and worry about money like no other, and you know, I don't even really worry about it anymore.
We've had other things happen that are unexplainable.
I mean, we had another instance where like we were kind of broke, and my grandma had just passed, and we needed to try and figure out finances to get back to Idaho and stuff to get to the funeral and everything. And
we prayed,
and we had just started, I think, tithing a little bit more because we weren't to where my goal was of where I wanted to be doing. And, you know, we were both just stressed and worried about finances and being able to make it back and all that stuff. And then out of the blue, you know, her grandma sent her a check that we've, you know, in the whole 11 years we've been together, we've never gotten a card or a check or anything from her grandma, and just randomly sent it to us. And that was our gas to get back to see my grandma's funeral and all that stuff. And, you know, and yeah, just all our bills are paid, and it's...
We never stress about money anymore. It's never, like, financially, we are so much more secure now than we have ever been in the 11 years that we've been together. Like, it's not even a thought. And we've had other times where we've just received money out of the blue that we weren't expecting, or like our mortgage. We went to pay our mortgage and they were like, you don't have to pay this month. And we were
weird.
Like, what do you mean we don't have to pay this month? Like, there's nothing else that could explain it than God providing for us and knowing, like, in that moment we needed that.
I was just trying to read scriptures and stuff and find something that kind of tied into how we've been blessed through tithing and stuff like that. And I mean, I guess what I would just say to people is, along with her, but also, I mean, that in 2 Corinthians, I found this one that was just talks about, you know, God's love for a person who gives cheerfully, and he provides all that you need, and, you know, he always will.
If you're coming to church, you believe. So why don't you believe that God is going to provide for you in all circumstances? Like, if you are a true believer, he's going to take care of you. There's no doubt in my mind that he won't make sure that you're provided for in some way.
Isn't that incredible stuff? Just a couple of statements that she made. I don't stress about money anymore. And in 11 years, I've never felt financially more secure than we do right now. And isn't that what some of you are feeling today? You're stressed and insecure, and what you want to feel is peace and security in the area of money. Father, this is a heart issue, and we just pray over the heart issues that we all face. It's not a rich thing, it's not a poor thing, not single, not married, it's just a heart thing. And admittedly, God, it's difficult to trust you, can't see you. And how can I trust this God to, what, are you just going to drop money out of the sky, out of the blue, just out of nowhere for me? And God might say, you have no idea where that money might come from. But if you put God first in your giving, he will prioritize you for your living. And he's so trustworthy, and he's so good. So good. So Father, would you just sweep across the cords of our hearts today? Talk to us where we need to be spoken to. Let's put more trust in you. And church, this is a new year, and I'm happy to tell you he is the same old God. And the same old God is the God, the Bible tells us, who numbers the stars, calls them each by name. And because of his great and mighty power, not one of them isn't where it's supposed to be. That because of God, there is not one atom, not one molecule that is not doing what it was meant to do in this universe, because God's large and in charge. That's the God that we serve. Would you stand to your feet with me today, church? Pastor Chloe's going to lead us in a song. As she sings this song, would you make a commitment to trusting the same old God in this brand new year, the God that provides for all the things that we need? And then we're going to make this so incredibly, incredibly practical today. Before you leave, our servers are going to be standing at the back door with the offering buckets. I mean, the Bible is like a bucket of paint. It's only useful when you apply it. I mean, a bucket of paint on a shelf in the basement is doing nobody any good. And the Word of God without being applied by us is really doing no good. So we want to make this incredibly practical for you today. So if God put it on your heart to begin this 2021 year by being a tither, 10% of your income, and you want to give, we'll give you the opportunity. You can still use your phone to give. You can still find the number on the bulletin. If you want to do it electronically, that's awesome. If you want to put a check or some cash back here in a bucket, you can do that when we are finished today. We just want to make this so practical for you. And then I would love to hear the stories that will follow your obedience. The stories that will follow your obedience. Daniel and Monica, whom you saw in the interview, that was not, I did not pay them to say this. Like, God paid them. God paid them. He provided for them. As we begin to sing, if you just want to worship for a moment and just maybe marinate the message, would you just do that this morning? It's about trusting God. I will trust you. And if you want to come and bend a knee at the altar and just say, God, I do want to trust you, but I need some more faith. Just come and find that place. Pastor Chloe, just lead us out in this. And let's just worship him today. Father, we just trust to you, Lord. There's nowhere else to go.
I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build
yes.
my life.
Father, there is nobody else. I would occasionally attend a mainline denomination church still here in Williston, still open and stuff. And we had mailboxes in the church, and my mother was the secretary, and they'd stuff our mailboxes with a box of offering envelopes. And they were dated, so you knew what day to bring that envelope back to church. And I can remember having that box of envelopes with the best of intentions in my room. And once in a great while, on a Saturday night, I would take an envelope from the box. Just bear with me here for a little bit. Don't ooh and ah over this. Sometimes I would put as much as $3 in that envelope. Three. Some of you are going, well, what's wrong with three? Like, no, three. And then I would seal up the envelope and put it on my desk or the dresser, ready to go to church the next day. Then, Sunday morning would come, and I'd get my church clothes on, and I would pick up my envelope and open it and take the $3 back out. How could I possibly part with $3 to the church? Once I accepted Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior, I couldn't wait to express my love, my trust, and my gratitude to Jesus and put my tithe, my 10%, in that offering plate. And that was the starting point. And Robin and I have never, ever, ever looked back. We can tell you story after story after story about how God provided for us. The times we were at Bible college and lived off less than $5,000 a year. It was just an incredible time in our life. One morning, I'm just in prayer. I'm over in the sanctuary early at chapel in the college saying, oh God, we need something. Because I had said to her earlier that morning before I left for class, I said, we need some more milk. She said, honey, we don't have money to buy milk. So I'm over there praying, just seeking the face of God. And after chapel service, everybody runs to the post office on campus because that's when the mail was out. And in the mail, there was a card from Grandma. Don't you love grandmas? Inside the card, it said, "A little birdie told me that you might need some help." And there was a check for $750. I bought the cow, right? I'm just telling you, this is the way God works. He really, really does. If you want to start that journey, ushers, would you just be at the back doors with an offering bucket back there? And if you want to start that obedience, right, today would be an awesome day to do it. Robin and I love you. The staff loves you. We're so grateful for all of you today. And we just want to pray a blessing over you. If you want to shake our hand, extend your hand. If you're not comfortable with that, it's not a problem. We love you. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us like you do, providing for us like you do, being trustworthy like you are. You're an amazing God, good and gracious in all things. And I just pray you're a faith builder in the hearts of all those that are in this place today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you, church.